It is 1 o'clock. We're going to go ahead and get started. So thanks everybody for joining us. This is the very first like digital playthrough of Splintered Lands. Splintered Lands is not a video game. It is a board game that will be coming to you in the near future. However, you know, we wanted to be able to showcase the game to people all over the place. And so we had a amazing gentleman who I will later promote build our game into Tabletop Simulator, which allows us to showcase the game. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and get started.
Life has always been a gamble. But to live as a splinter is to cheat death.
So Splintered Lands is a deck-building, tactical, base defense card battler game, which is a whole bunch of things to say that my partner Jeff and I designed a game that had a lot of elements that we really like from board games and, you know, put them into one game. And then there's a lot of kind of unique things that go on. I'm not going to go crazy rules heavy on this playthrough. I'm going to kind of describe things as you see them and as they come up. That way it's not, you know, me doing expose for the first like 10 minutes about how the game works. But the general gist of the game is I am in charge of this area down here. This is known as my enclave. And I play cards to these walls to defend against Jeff's enclave attempting to attack me. We both go to the center area here known as the dunes to either fight it out or attempt to acquire new people to join our side, essentially. So the game plays pretty smooth, and I'm going to go ahead and get started. So the first thing you do is you pick one or you pick three, sorry, of your favorite factions. Right now, the base game comes with four. We have five expansions already in the works, and each expansion adds two whole factions and one additional kind of like funsy thing that throws in there. So it adds like 14 cards, essentially, of like something unique, something that enhances the game in some way, shape, or form, like events or more attachments or equipment or things of that nature. The cards or factions we're going to be playing with this time are the Splinters, the Ravagers, and the Mercenaries. Those are four factions in the game. I'm going to give this a shuffle. Okay, so to start the game, you shuffle those three decks that you like or three factions together. You basically take any three and you slam them together. And then you shuffle and deal into the center row. I'm going to play the first player hand. So I'm going to shuffle my starting cards and I'm going to deal myself four of them. Jeff is going to shuffle his. He's going to deal himself six because he gets to start with a full wall of people against my beginning attack. So the cards all have kind of the same rough layout to them. You'll see in the top side, there's the name of the card. So in this case, the basic cards are called Scouts. Then you can see the word basic on there. That's their traits, essentially. Those are like little keywords that work for that character. And then there's ability text, which is all the stuff in the middle. Basically, scouts are the most basic card that you start with. You can abandon them, which is to kind of get rid of them out of your hand later. They can be upgraded into other things. And then you see a two and a one. The two in dark gray is their attack power, essentially how much ability to attack the other player they bring to the table. And then the white is their defensive power, essentially the amount. And Paul, I will not be casting Dark Ritual. Good luck with that. Okay, so now to start, I place my cards to any of my wall spots. So I'm going to go ahead and get started. And Jeff is going to be able to see what's going on. Jeff gets to play two to his reserves area, which you can see are these two face down cards right here. So I don't get to know what those are. And that's kind of, those are his cards in his base, basically in reserve. So there is a turn order. You can see right here, the turn order is always deployment. So to start the game, the first thing you do is you attack. So I am going to take any amount of cards that I want from my side and place them in the deployment area and declare which of Jeff's walls I want to attack. So I'm going to take these three cards with me and I am going to tell Jeff, let's see, let me look at his side of the board. I'm going to tell Jeff I'm going to attack this side. So I have declared that I am attacking Jeff's essentially from my perspective, right wall, from his perspective, left wall. what that means is Jeff is now deciding whether or not he wants to bring this card into the fight. Otherwise, it is just this card and this card who are defending his base right now, because I've attacked that side of his base. Basically, my attack is so fast that these people won't be able to participate unless it's passively, because they won't be able to run over there and get there. When you attack, you declare a wall. So in this case, like, I declared this one, but I could have declared the front one, which would mean these two cards are defending and these two reserve cards could support. And or I could attack this side, which means these two cards are defending and this card could support. So in this case, I'm attacking this side. I tell Jeff I'm bringing, in this case, 2, 4, 6 damage to this wall. Jeff now needs to decide whether or not he wants to reveal this card to aid in the defense. So, Jeff?
I will not be revealing that
card. Okay, Jeff isn't going to reveal because he thinks he's either going to take that damage or he's just going to go ahead and let it happen. So he doesn't reveal, so he doesn't flip. I declare how much damage I'm bringing to the table by saying I'm bringing 6. Jeff is defending.
And I've got 3.
You've got 3? Okay, Jeff is defending at 3. So these two cards will be defeated. My cards all go away because they're really tired. So they go to the treatment pile so they can rest up and try again. Jeff will take 3 damage because that was the overflow amount of damage that he was not able to protect. And then the next action is the fortify phase. So now I put cards back on my wall to prepare for hopefully Jeff's next attack. In this case, I'm going to do this. And Jeff isn't cheating and definitely not watching the stream. Okay. So now that I have fortified my wall, the next phase is dunes. That's this guy right here. So dunes is where things get really, really fun. And this is the thing we're probably the most proud of. So as the commander of an enclave, you have authority and you start with a lot of it. You basically walked out into the desert, found a place and said, here be my home. I now need to convince people to come and help me. You started with these people. These people agree with what you believe in. They want to help you do all the things. But now you have to use that authority to go and convince other people that they want to come and join you. And that authority is represented in a lot of things. It's like resources to feed people. It's weapons to keep them up to date. It's repairs. It's everything, right? So everything is your authority power. It's also your life. So if you lose all of your authority, you're done, right? If you haven't been able to convince enough people to support you to be able to survive, you're done. And so we have a really interesting mechanic. So when you go to the dunes, the point of going to the dunes is you saw something cool out in the dunes that you wanted. And in this case, that's something cool that you saw out in the dunes, you get to see for free. So the first thing you do during dunes phase is you reveal one card from the center row, any one of these 5 cards, for free, essentially. It didn't cost you anything. Somebody said, yo, I think there's something out there in the dunes we should go get. So I'm going to reveal this card. So this is Wastelander. And I'm going to talk about the cards really quick. So Wastelander is the name of the card. You can see a symbol slightly to the left of that. That's the faction that that card belongs to. In this case, she belongs to the Splintered faction, as denoted by the crossed axes. These are people that essentially were kicked out into the wilderness who have no previous faction affiliation. They generally tend to be fairly self-sufficient, and they blend into the other groups. Then if you look to the upper right, you see a 3, a big number 3. That big number 3 is the authority cost. If I want to convince this Wastelander to join my side, I'm going to have to pay 3 of my authority in order to convince them to join me and then also house them, upkeep them, all of those things. You can also see a smaller number 3, slightly down and to the left. That is their faction synergy. And I'll get to faction synergies later. But essentially what it means is, in this case, if I had 3 splinters in either a defense or an attack, I can trigger their faction synergy. These are very powerful abilities that are basically not game breaking, but they change the nature of the game pretty significantly for that turn. You can also see the up arrowed chevrons, those 3 chevrons. That means field promote. If I acquire this character, it will automatically promote one of my scouts or sentries into that character. So I would essentially get to trade this card for one of my scouts and sentries. That helps me to thin out my deck. It helps me to, you know, keep the game flowing and be able to get to my better cards faster. You also see where it says splinter, close, and versatile. Those are the traits essentially for that character. They are part of the splintered faction and they have the close and versatile trait. And then their ability text says during your dunes phase, instead of acquiring a card normally, you may acquire a card if able. The top card of the dunes discard pile for half its authority cost and place it in your treatment pile. Basically, what this means is if I had this card and she was out and I was doing my Dunes phase, I would be able to acquire cards from the Dunes discard pile, which we'll talk about in a sec, for half. So she would cost two because it's half rounded up. So I've revealed my first card. Now comes the bidding mechanic. This is where things get really fun. I have to pre-spend all of the authority I want to use this turn right now, having only seen this one card. However, there are gates. Because Jeff has 100 authority, I can only purchase cards between 0 and 3 cost. When he is at 90, then I open up the next gate. So I am restricted from just paying a ton, buying everything, because Jeff has more authority in the area than I do, right? Or in this case, Jeff hasn't reached those gates. So right now, Jeff is above 90 points, which means I can only acquire cards from 0 to 3 cost. So it's not beneficial for me to say spend all of it, right, and just buy every card in the center, because I can't. It's when Jeff's authority reaches those thresholds. So right now, I think I'm going to spend, I know I want to acquire Wastelander. It's a good card. It's a 3/3 for 3 with abilities and promotes. I think I'm going to spend, I probably want to reveal at least 2 more. Hope I get lucky. So 3, 4, 5 plus those, which would be 6. So I'm going to spend 8. Oops. Oh, shoot. There we go. 8. I'm going to spend 8. And I'm going to flip this one over. So I have 7 left.
Lucky.
So yeah, very lucky. Jeff, you're not gonna be able to see this card. I don't think we shuffled. I was gonna say, go ahead and shuffle. Hang on a sec. We should do like this. I've revealed 2. I'm gonna get really lucky. There we go.
Luck, quote end quote.
Luck. It was luck, gentlemen and ladies. As it happens, I am going to purchase both of these. So I'm gonna go ahead and do that. I'm gonna set these aside really quick. I'm gonna field promote 2 cards. Because they both of them had the field promote. And then I'm going to stick these guys in my treatment pile. So those guys are no longer a part of my game. And then the last thing you do is you discard. So this is, again, where things get fun. Jeff doesn't get this card now. So this card is going to get burned. And I'll show that by doing this. That card disappears forever. The sands swallowed up. It, you know, it is no longer a part of the game, essentially. And then I deal myself a new hand of cards. Which is, you know, whatever remaining cards are here, and then it shuffles my treatment pile back in and then deals those back out. And now play goes to Jeff. So if you notice, Jeff now only has the remaining cards from that previous combat, right? You're basically always in a position of trying to play catch up, because Jeff doesn't have a full wall. So part of the strategy of Splintered Lands is, when is it a good time to attack? When is it a good time to defend? When is a good time to swing with everything? When is a good time to come back? Because you only draw 5 cards, but you have 6 wall spaces, which means if you send everything, you're always going to be down, right? If you don't send enough, you're not dealing enough damage to your opponent. So Jeff is deploying, and he is bringing reserve cards. So the way that this happens is Jeff will say, I'm bringing whatever this damage is, right? 2 in this case, plus this card, plus this card. So we say that 2 plus plus, because I don't get to see these 2 cards until I make decisions on my end. So, Jeff, which wall are you going to attack?
I'm going to head that away.
Yes, perfect. Okay, so Jeff declares he's going this way, which means these 2 cards are defending. In this case, I am choosing whether or not I want to reveal this card to aid in my side of the defense, essentially. I have 92 hit points, and this is where things get iffy, right? Because I just spent 8, which means now I'm down hit points, authority. And the next gate is 90. So when the enemy is at 90 resources, you can buy 0 to 5 cost cards. So Jeff only has to do 2 damage to me, and I have to prevent that 2 damage, or he has a better buying advantage than I do. So in this case, he's going to deal 2. I'm going to block 4. My fear is that both of these are scouts. If they are, he's going to deal 6, and I'm going to take the damage, and I don't think I can block that. So I'm not going to reveal. So I say I'm not revealing. Jeff then reveals both of his cards. Yep, and he did. So
he didn't weep.
Right. So if I'm just going to show if I would have revealed this card, then I would have had 5 total defense against his 6, which would have only dealt me 1 and would have been there. I was hoping that he only had one of these. So okay, so I'm going to take these 2 take 4 of that damage. But Jeff is dealing six, unfortunately, so I will go down two. So now Jeff is very able to purchase at the 0-5 cost marker. So next, he fortifies his base. And while he's choosing what to do, I'm going to talk about this card right here. So this is an attachment card. And as you can see, there's numbers that go around the outside. Essentially, those are bonus defensive abilities. And attachment cards, when purchased, go directly to your wall spots like this. They never go into your deck. Essentially, there's something you found out into the wilderness, dragged it back, and bolted it to the front of your enclave, and now it sits there to defend. When it defends, you essentially take damage by rotating it. So this one, in this case, has three defense on its first phase. Then it can change, and it will have two defense on its next phase, as denoted by the number that is facing up. So that is how that works. Jeff has revealed a Wastelander. Aww. And is only going to spend enough to purchase it. He's 100% going to beat me this game. He already knows what he's doing. So now he's abandoning one of his cards and promoted because that card had field promote, and his turn is over. So he will burn the next card in the group, and it will be my turn. And play continues like this, you know, for the rest of the game. Oh, I need to turn that around. There we go. Okay, so I am going. So it's my deployment phase. I am going to attempt to attack Jeff. I'm going to go this way again. Jeff, I'm bringing 1++.
Okay, I'm not going
to
reveal.
Jeff is not revealing, so I'm going to reveal that I am bringing 5 damage to Jeff's 4. He will take 1. I will then play cards, fortify, and thank you. And then it is my Dunes face. Now, I have this awesome thing going on here where I have the Wastelander, like which we just talked about. Instead of going to the Dunes, I could purchase this card for half its cost. It's not a terrible card. Because I have 2 of them, I could theoretically purchase up armored walls as well. Don't know if I want to. I still get to see 1 card for free. So let's go reveal this one. Oh no. Yeah, there's no way I can afford this. Okay, so this is Reaper of the Walls. And this is one of the really interesting things that happens in the game. This is a 7 cost card. I can't buy it right now. If Jeff were to do enough damage to me later, he'd be able to purchase it. But you notice how the faction affiliation symbol in the left-hand corner is a gold color? That means this card is unique. So there's only 1 of these in the game, and it is Reaper of the Walls. It has a very powerful ability. It does 7 damage, has 4 defense. Essentially, our 7 cost cards are like the legendaries, kind of people of that faction that really like make up that faction, or like core to that faction. And the mercenary faction is all about synergy and grouping together and doing things effectively. So, Jeff, I can't buy that card. I can still choose whether or not I want to buy these 2. I think I'm going to. So I'm going to buy this card or 2. And he has field promote, so I'm going to go ahead and get this. So 1, 2. And then I'm going to buy... Whoop. Did I buy both of those? Ah, there it is. And then I am also going to buy this card for 2 as well. So I will spend 2 more. I'm going to attach this card. Let's just put it here. And then he goes there. And my turn is over. And I feel promoted and I'm done. Okay. So now play goes back to Jeff. And Jeff starts his turn by attacking me. He is going 1++. And he's taking the smart choice. Yeah, exactly. 1++, I'm at 86. It doesn't matter. I've got 5 defense. He's theoretically hitting for a maximum of 5, but potentially plus what he purchased. So, no, I'm not going to reveal. I think okay, he's still deal. Got just basic cards. I was correct. So these 2, he's swinging for 5. 2 plus 2 plus 1. And I have 5 defense. So those are done. And then Jeff fortifies. Let's see. Still doing okay. Okay, perfect. And we have hit the 20-minute mark. So anybody who is currently watching, go ahead. So let's try this dance again. If you're watching right now, and now that you can hear me, go ahead and leave a comment. Let's just throw an F in the chat for, you know, me totally not having that ready to go on the giveaway panel. So if you leave a comment, we will get you entered to win one of these t-shirts. I have one on right now. That is a Civil Dawn logo on the front and a Splintered Lands logo on the back. And yeah, so I've got a whole bunch of swag over there to my left. Okay, perfect. So yeah, thank you all for telling me. So while Jeff has himself fortified, Jeff, go ahead and do your dunes phase.
Alrighty. Chris, to answer your question from earlier, the answer is yes. Those cards that get field promoted do go out of the game forever. When you field promote a scout or a sentry, they leave the game forever.
Perfect.
Alrighty. And I can get fours and fives, so I'm actually going to do some spending here.
You can. So Jeff is going to do... So Jeff has hit his mid-game, essentially. Once that 4-5 range opens up, it really kind of behooves you to sometimes. Some people like to play go big or go home. Other people, you know, not a big fan. But Jeff is absolutely... And he's spending 10, so it's not super big. We've seen people spend, you know, 20 or 30 to try and, like, sweep the whole board. That usually happens once that 80 number is broken. So Jeff has acquired two cards from the center row. And you didn't buy squad leader? I'm a little shocked.
Yeah, I mean, I don't feel great about it, but there was two fours I had to.
I saw that. Okay, so Jeff's turn is over. He has gone to the dunes, and he purchased. I unfortunately wasn't paying too much attention, but it looked like he had a really good purchase. I really need to get him down 3 hit points. I feel like this one's a trap. I feel like this side, if I look at Jeff's board, he's got a 3 and a 1, so he's defending for 4, but I'm betting this is a century. And well, even if this is a century 2, I'm still okay. So yeah, I'm gonna deploy 3++, and I'm going this way. I don't like leaving that Wastelander up there, because it gives him purchase advantage for whatever's gonna pop up next turn. But I think that's my best bet, because I'm hoping that this is, you know, either something...
I'm not gonna turn it.
Oh, you're not?
I think you
okay,
got me.
Perfect.
No,
he's gonna let me go big. Okay, so I'm swinging for 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Versus his 3 defense, so he will take 4. And that has now opened up the board. So Jeff is beyond 80 hit points, or 80 authority. So in this case, I now can buy anything, which, you know, brings about the mid-game, or the beginning of the mid-game. Okay. So I've deployed. I'm going to reveal one for free. Militia's good. I don't know if I want to spend a bunch to buy it. I'm really disappointed I can't buy Squad Leader. It's a very good card. Personal opinion, it's one of the best 2-cost cards in the game, but everybody has different opinions about it. I think I am going to go big, though. I think I'm going to spend, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, plus 7 is 11, plus 6 is 17. I'm going to spend 20. We're going to do something crazy. I'm hoping there's some big cards out there right now. So I'm going to reveal this. Oh, that's so unfortunate. Okay.
Oh, it is, isn't it?
It is. Okay, so this is Persistent Strain. This is one of the legendary, quote-unquote, cards for the Splinter Faction. It's also, a very unique card in that you can only buy it if you already own Patient X. So in the Splintered Lands world, there was a calamity that happened, essentially, and a bioweapon was released onto the world, which we may or may not have to change because we designed this game 6 years ago before that stuff happened. But whatever. Point is, Patient X is literally the original Patient X. And there are cards called strain cards, which essentially allow Patient X to mutate into something. So, yeah. And I unfortunately can't buy him. It's incredibly unfortunate. So I'm going to reveal this. Oh, there we go. There we go.
Oh, boy.
You're welcome. This is Ravager Buzz. The risk paid off.
Getting wrecked.
This is the leader of the Ravager faction. So he's a big hitter. But what some of you will notice is that he has zero defense. But Steve, if he has zero defense, how does he live? Zero is not the end result, essentially, in our game. So while he's sitting there either defending or attacking, if he were to take any damage, because he has zero defense, he would then be fatigued. But while he's still sitting at zero and has no and has not taken any damage, he is alive. His ability, however, can just wipe out another player's board if you have a bunch of ravagers. So
real quick there, Steve, Eric has an excellent question in the chat there.
So you commit your bid before you start flipping cards, or do you always get the first card before you commit your bid, but you only get one? And then after that, you have to commit your bid. And also, this is a really good question. I bid 20. That's a lot, right? Interestingly, if I don't spend it, I lose it. It's gone. I brought up a whole bunch of stuff, right? And essentially, I'm in trouble. Like if I don't use it. So right now, like the maximum I'm spending is 9. But I need to make sure I note I've spent 2 flipping cards, because each additional card you want to reveal costs 1. So I'm gonna flip this one. Oh, Richter Stonewall.
Oh, my. An
excellent card. Also in the Ravager faction. And Veteran Militia. Okay, so that cost me... Whoops, that cost me 2 more cards. I need to note that. So I have 7... I have 16. I can afford... So I can't afford all 3 of these, which would be extremely fortuitous. Because he's a 6, so that would be 13. But I can afford Militia... Don't know if I want to, and none of these field promote, so that's also frustrating. Veteran Militia is very good, but I don't think it's better than Richter at the moment. So I'm gonna buy Ravager Boz for 7. 6, 7. And then I'm gonna buy Richter Stonewall for 6. And then I'm gonna buy Militia for 2. I have 1 left over. I'm not gonna get to use it. So done. And then hopefully we get lucky and I get some decent cards.
That round hurt.
That, I mean, maybe it didn't hurt as much as it could have. It was definitely better than my previous round. So I'm not mad. Oops. I'm not mad at all. Okay. Let's see. So Michael Stockton, we have a lot of amazing artwork. These pieces right here, so this is just placeholder art, right? It basically means it's in the pipes or it's working. But we have been blessed to work with artists from all over the place. This is Pedro Silva. He is one of the artists to work with us kind of early on. This is Lubov. She has made a lot of pieces for us. This is another one of hers. We also were blessed to work with Sam Eastwick. Out of, I believe he's in London. He's a tattoo artist, and he has made some incredible pieces for us. We have art in the works for all 5 expansions. We're hoping that our Kickstarter funds well enough so that we can actually bring those expansions to life. We will have artwork to show for those too. So I'm really excited. We have some crazy good looking art. Okay, Jeff, you are attacking where? Jeff is bringing 2++ to this side. What do I have here? I'm not going to reveal. So Jeff, yep, is swinging for 6. I am defending at 4, so I will take 2. And it is his fortify phase. Oh, that's very unfortunate. Oh, thankfully it's Persistent Strain. So he has a Wastelander out, which means he could theoretically buy the top card for 1/2, but it is Persistent Strain. Because he doesn't have Patient X already on his board, he cannot buy Persistent Strain. We have a whole kind of mechanic that's going to be built around the Strain cards and some of the art coming up for them. Jeff, who just submitted like the first draft for one of those first Strain cards?
Remember that was Pedro Silva.
Was it Pedro? Okay, yeah. It looks awesome. I'm very excited for it.
Yes.
Yeah. In fact, we just posted. So we post art almost weekly, sometimes less, sometimes more, but almost weekly on our Instagram and Facebook, basically doing artist features. So if you're watching right now, you guys absolutely should go and give those artists just a ton of likes and all of the praise because they are working incredibly hard for us. So Chris says, cards have to say field promote to allow you to kick some people out, typically your weakest guys, so the strong guys go into your hand. So it, yes and no. Field promote essentially means this guy became better, right? So really what's happening is this guy, I wasn't kicking this guy out, but in the theme of the world is this guy who I field promoted became this guy, right? So he just got better at what he does. We remove them from the game because you start with 11 cards in your hand, but these are the weakest cards, and you don't want to keep them for the whole game because then otherwise your deck gets kind of bulked up. And so, you know, you want to field promote is really good. There are cards that allow you to just remove people. Oh my gosh, if you flip Patient X, I'm going to be so upset. Oh, he went big. Jeff is spending 24. And it looks like it's paying off slightly. So he's got Up Armored Walls as an option. Blood Sage, another amazing piece from Sam.
Gonna be some loss here.
Yeah, you're gonna lose a little bit. So it wasn't super great. Fleshy Phalanx is a good one. Love that name, by the way. The art for that looks fantastic. It didn't make it into this alpha version of the game, but imagine a wall made of punji sticks and people stuck to it. Our game is adult. So if you've got very young kids, it's up to you to decide whether or not you want to let them play. Jeff, if you're buying all those, some of those attachments go straight up onto the board, bro.
You bet they do.
Yeah, ooh, I'm very aware that they do.
You caught me.
So when you purchase attachments, they don't ever go to your treatment pile. So Chris says it's like trying to carry the bard throughout a bunch of campaigns. Hey, listen, bards help. Okay, this is incredibly topical because I was playing the bard in our Gloomhaven group just recently, and the joke was I had to keep track of all the damage I was helping deal because they were like, man, bard doesn't do anything. And I'm salty about it. I'm a salty bard. Okay. Well, that I should never have said that. That's 100% about to become cut and gift.
Okay. You are a salty bard.
I am a salty bard, apparently. Okay. So Jeff's turn is done. Man, your wall got real scary all of a sudden. He's got two defenders, one at two, one at three. Okay, medic. This is the get down, Mr. President card. This card is incredibly annoying, but is a great card. So essentially, if I were to kill one of his cards or fatigue one of his cards, the medic basically says, get down, Mr. President, and jumps in the way of that and trades places. So if I were to kill his Wastelander or fatigue his Wastelander, for instance, then the medic could be like, nah, just kidding, and bring the Wastelander back. So, yeah. Okay. We're going to pause really quick. I'm going to go back to live. If you effed in the chat, I'm going to write down those people and I will ping you later for getting a t-shirt. Okay, let's go back to this. What happened?
Eric's
salty bard. There's actually a card named that's, we call him bard. Me.
Already thinking about, oh god, that's
there's
that's,
apparently gonna be an alternate too good. Art. Yeah,
that is way too good.
Oh, that's funny. Okay. Where do I want to tag? Gosh dang, your wall got, oh, this is the Callmaster. Also, the art for the Callmaster looks amazing. This is a way you can get rid of cards in the without having to field promote them, right? So the Callmaster says when Callmaster is fatigued from your wall or reserves, you may abandon up to two cards. Essentially, when he goes away, you'd be like, I'm taking two of you with me. But they're permanently removed from the game. So he sacrifices other people along with himself. So yeah, he's a fun card. Okay. I don't know what to do. I have to go for it. Hope I'm able to put enough hurt on. So I'm gonna go this way. Because reasons. So I'm swinging reasons. For 3++. Okay. Plus because reasons.
Since because reasons. I right. will not reveal.
You're not going to reveal? Okay. So I am swinging for 3, 4, 5, 6 against this. So the first thing that happens is I come up against his up-armored walls. So they're going to absorb 3 of that 6 right away. He rotated his card essentially to indicate that it had taken the damage. Now he has to deal with an additional three. Callmaster has 3 hit points and Sentry has 2. So the interesting thing here is the only card he has to lose at this point is Sentry, because Sentry can take 2 of the 3 points that I sent over. Callmaster can absorb that last remaining 1. And because it was not enough damage to get him to 0 and that he took damage, he won't go away. So Jeff is going to get away essentially with not taking any damage and only having to fatigue his Sentry.
I'll tell you what, I'm going to actually do something different.
What?
I'm going to let you kill the Coldmaster.
Why?
We're going to go ahead and fatigue a couple of sentries from my hand.
See, okay. So what happened there was he actually allowed the Coldmaster to get killed. And instead he got to thin out his deck. He got to remove 2 cards from his, this is some advanced play level stuff. Okay.
I considered waiting a turn, but
it was the right choice. Yeah. Okay, so my deployment is done. I need to let's see. Let's do it. Okay. So now I'm gonna reveal Powder Finger. Okay, he's good. I don't know if he's useful right now. The nice part about Powder Finger is he deals 1 damage to everybody in a situation. So it can be really good. But I don't think it's useful, although I have enough Ravagers that would be a useful card. I think I'm going to spend 15. Okay. Yeah, I'm going to spend 15. I can't buy Persistent Strain, otherwise I would absolutely be using Wastelander. So let's go back here. Squad leader, good. Man, I'm getting 2'd out. 2, 3. So that was 2, 3. Ooh, okay. So I've spent 3. I have 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I could scoop all of them, but I'm really hoping this is a 5 or a 6. If it is a 6, I would be okay. If it's a 7, I'm in trouble. It is Fiery Pool of Blood. Okay, Fire Pool of Blood is really good. I think now would be a good time to do it too. So Fire Pool of Blood states that if he tries to attack me, he just takes 3 damage. Doesn't matter what happens, but if you notice, the 3 at the top of this card has like a silver kind of background on it. That means that it is optional whether or not you want to deal damage to this card. So he could, in theory, just jump through the Fiery Pool of Blood, but he's going to take 3 damage no matter what. The problem is because I poured a giant pool of blood out front of my base and then lit it on fire, I'm always now taking 1 damage for the rest of the game, essentially, or until Fiery Pool of Blood is gone. So it's risk-reward. If there's 10 more rounds, I'm going to take 10 additional damage. That hurts. So yeah, I think I'm going to buy both. So that's going to be, so I had 11, it's going to be 10. So I will take, Blood Sage, who field promotes. So goodbye you. And then I will take Fire Pool of Blood and I'll drop him right there. And then my turn is now over.
While you're in your Dunes phase real quick, I'm going to activate Medic's Interruption ability here.
No,
it's
going to
let me fatigue him and then bring Callmaster back. So we're
there was the get down, Mr. President. He got to sacrifice 2 dudes. Medic got to do his job and he gets his Callmaster back, which means he also has a 4-3 available to do things. So, okay. And it is now Jeff's turn. So while Jeff is taking his turn, it's been 20 more minutes. I'm going to get another giveaway started, except this time I am going to give away some dice. So if you are watching right now, okay, so if you're watching right now, we have these dice for sale still on our website. And if you would like to buy a set, you can. Otherwise, go ahead and leave me a solid F in the chat, and I will get you entered to win one. We will send you, they are custom Civil Dawn Games dice. They have our logo on them. You can see that in the, I can't point all the way up there, but the 20. on a D20. They come with a certificate of authenticity letting you know that you supported us. We'll put your name on our website in our Hall of Heroes area. You can go and see all the other people that have supported us. And all of the money from that goes to paying for the art. So we have been, you know, incredibly upfront kind of about the financials and where things go. And the money from dice sales doesn't go to us under any circumstances. We're using it to pay for art because it is just Jeff and I funding this game. So yeah, we work extra hard lots of nights and weekends, and we're spending all of our own money and hopefully money that you give us by buying dice. Shameless plug. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you could win a set. Okay, so Jeff is attacking. Jeff, which wall are you attacking?
We're going, it doesn't really matter. It's going to be rough either way. We're going to go this way.
Okay, so Jeff is attacking with ++, which means I have no idea what he's swinging with. I'm going to assume he's just schluffing an attack.
Oh, no, this is big stuff. Big stuff.
Yeah, big stuff. Big stuff.
Big stuff. Big stuff. Yeah, great stuff.
I'm expecting a scout and a sentry, so I'm not going to reveal.
You were close.
I was very close. Okay, so he's swinging for 4. I have up armored walls in the way, though, so up armored walls is going to absorb 3 of it because he has to deal with up armored walls first. Whoops, and that went the wrong way. And then there is 1 making it through, so I won't even have to lose my sentry. Big stuff. Big stuff.
Big stuff.
Big stuff.
As I said, big
huge,
stuff.
Huge stuff.
Huge.
Yeah. What Taylor, thank you very much. Solid F for the dice. They, man, if you like clicky-clacky math rocks, these things are gorgeous. Gorgeous dice. They have, like, dark smoke in them, so we call them umbral vapors. They look awesome. I'm a big clicky-clacky math rocks fan. They are resin, so, you know, take for the grain of salt any imperfections that may exist. Schluffing is a technical term. Yep. Schluffing is definitely a technical term. I think we use it in the military all the time. Jeff, what you doing?
Oh, we're just doing a little thinking. We're going to...
Big!
We're going to do one more. Oh, yeah, one more
okay.
Big bit here.
Let's see.
One,
did it pay
two,
off?
Three.
Ooh, Heavy Gunner Deacquisition Forcer. Ah, another Pedro Silva piece from us. This is a really good way to get rid of cards. So somebody asked earlier, are you just killing guys? This one is. This is Deacquisition Enforcer. He's literally going up and saying, gonna have to go all out, kid. Thanks for your time. And straight murking it, dude. So if you ever want to get rid of somebody in a very violent way, you purchase Deacquisition Enforcer, because at the end of your Dunes phase, you may abandon a card. Jeff purchased Heavy Gunner. Great card. Let's see where else you spending that big money, son.
We're gonna get that old squad later for sure.
Make sure you remember he field promotes.
Yes, thank you.
Yep, as much as I would rather you forget, I ain't trying to be that kind of mean.
Well, you're all right. He field promotes as well, and then we're gonna do constable for the end there. So that's all 7. He's gonna go away. But before that, come back, Constable. Come back.
Yep. Get down, Mr. President.
1, 2.
Okay. Let's see. Okay. So it is my turn, and I have, hopefully, big swing. As big as I would. Close and made. Okay. So I'm going to swing these ++. So this is where things start getting interesting. The mid to late game area, you start having a lot of stuff. So if you notice, Ravager Boss has something called Brutal. What that does is it gives you bonus damage. But it only triggers if you have another card with Brutal or a card with Skilled. And I don't have it right now that Jeff can see. So I don't get the bonus damage. Richter Stonewall says, versatile allies have +1 defense. Close and melee cards, all of them, have -2 when targeting a wall occupied. So I'm not getting any bonuses from Richter Stonewall either. He's a great defender. I'm hoping that his 4 damage sneaks some stuff through for me. So, Jeff, I'm going to go this way because I don't want to let you call master me again.
You sure?
Also, I have to take one damage because at the start of my turn, fire pool of blood deals one damage to me. I'm glad that I remember.
Oh, yeah.
That. Yeah. Yeah, I think I forgot it when we were doing the playtests. I mean, I don't know.
Won't feel all right, bad. I will not reveal.
You're not going to reveal? Okay. Nope. So I'm going to reveal. So this is where it gets fun. So Militia, their general synergy is called Skilled. Skilled lets you trigger the general synergy of someone else, not that card. So for instance, if Militia had Brutal or Sunder or some other general synergy, they couldn't use their own Skilled ability to trigger it, but he has Skilled 1, so I can trigger one additional general synergy on somebody else. I am going to use that to trigger Brutal 1 on Ravager Boz. So in this case, Ravager Boz is now a 10-0 because he is getting one bonus damage from Brutal being triggered by the Militia's Skilled ability. Militia also states, while attacking with Militia, other close allies have plus 1. So Richter Stonewall is close, and he is also getting a bonus 1 from them. And they are not close. Ravager Boz is not close, so he will not be giving a bonus plus 1. So I am attacking with 10 plus 5, so 15, plus 3, so 18, plus 2, so 20, going Oof. This way. Yep, so Fleshy Phalanx will take 2, and there'll be 18 left. And he will absorb 4 of that 18 and take 12. And these guys are done. And then I will place some cards. I'm going to reveal. Okay, so now I'm going to use my Wastelanders because I'm going to buy this guy for 2 instead of going to the dunes. I'm going to buy him for 2. He does not field promote. And I'm going to buy, I'm actually going to buy the Powderfinger for 1 as well. So that cost me a total of 3 because I had 2 Wastelanders. I was able to double up on the amount of times I could use it. And buying him for 1, he's absolutely worth it. And then my turn is done. So Jeff won't get to see any additional cards, which is great. I won't be giving him any more information that he didn't previously have. So while Jeff is taking his turn, if anybody has questions about the game or its mechanics, feel free to put them in the chat. I will have no problem whatsoever, talking about it. Go ahead and get the vapors off. If you effed in the chat earlier for Umbo Vapors, you are now entered to get them. Jeff, which side are you going at?
We are going. We're going that away.
Jeff is going to go.
I can't mess with the fleshy pool there.
Yeah, you don't like taking 3 damage right away? Come on. Nah. Okay, so Jeff is swinging with 4 plus plus. And I'm defending with, what am I defending with? I've got 4, 5, 6. He's probably got more, but I don't think he's doing a big swing, although he has bought some big cards recently, and I haven't seen any of them. And that's my, well,
till now.
Whoops. I'm not going to reveal.
Why?
Yeah. I'm not going to reveal.
But there's okay, what you were expecting.
Okay, there's Powderfinger. That was a little cheating for those of you in the know. So Powderfinger states when Powderfinger attacks, deal 1 damage to each defending card being targeted by this attack. So in this case, he is going to be dealing 1 damage to this card, and this card. So they're automatically reduced by 1, which stinks. And then, oh no. Oh, okay. So this is our first use of a faction synergy. So again, things get really fun. The Ravagers have a faction synergy bonus or have a faction synergy called Devastating. If you noticed, Coalmaster has a 2 in that symbol, which means there only have to be 2 Ravagers present in either the attack or the defense to trigger this ability. He has Coalmaster and he also has Powderfinger. He counts as 1 of those, so he has the 2. That means that Coalmaster deals double damage. So the Devastating ability is that card, the one with the faction synergy symbol, deals double damage. So Coalmaster is actually swinging for 8. Thankfully, Powderfinger does not get this bonus. However, Okay, and you're not getting your breach or brutal abilities because they're not triggering from anybody. So you're swinging for 8 plus 3, so 11, 13. So you're swinging for 13, and these guys are reduced by 1.
That's right.
So this rotates, goes this way, and there's 12 left. He dies, and there's 10 left. That's one less. He dies, and there's 11 left. And he dies, and there's 10 left, and I will take 10.
Bingo.
Woof. Ow. Yeah, that hurt. And that is how faction synergies work. And when they work, they hit. Okay, and let's see. Jeff is fortifying. Missed that step. No, he hasn't missed it. He just stacked.
No.
Yeah. You all right?
Nice try.
Yeah. I'm doing well. Okay.
Yeah, it's too bad. Okay.
Ah, Scotty Boomerang Barnes. Fun fact about Scotty. We give him one rocket, and he keeps making it back alive. That's the joke with this character. Scotty has an interesting thing. So it's when he's defending, your allies have -1 defense. So he hurts you when he's standing on your wall. But when he attacks, one card has -3 defense. So you bring him with you, and he acts like a 6 damage card. But you can target a card and say, that card has -3 defense. And so he's a really good way to kind of counter somebody else's buffed cards. He can do a really great job of kind of getting rid of
it. I'm actually not going to purchase this round.
You're not
going
to purchase. Just so he's enacting the built-in abandoned mechanic on a basic card. Whoops, my head is in the way of that. Let's move over here. So it says, Sentry may be abandoned from your hand or treatment pile instead of acquiring a card from the dunes. You may only abandon one basic card per turn this way. So he's choosing not to buy something because he's, you know, getting down to the point where buying is maybe not necessarily the best answer. And instead, he is abandoning the card. And it is my turn. So I'm going to... I don't think I'm going to do much more purchasing. So I'm going to do some swinging. And I'm going to do it... What do you got? Constable... Ooh, versatile. Yeah, but it's only if that card's versatile. I'm going to go up the middle. Yeah, I'm taking 6 plus up the middle.
Hmm.
So he's defending at 5, 7.
Sorely tempted to let you do it.
I know you are. This is the risk play. He doesn't know what I have. And right now I'm telling him I don't have enough damage to get through it, but would I be silly enough to make that mistake and him not have to reveal? But if he reveals one of these cards, it's gone no matter what. So he could use it to save one of his other cards. Like if he really wants to save Constable, for instance, if he reveals and I don't have enough damage, then yes, he baited me, but he saves Constable. However, if he doesn't reveal and I do have enough damage, he's going to lose Constable and Sentry. So
I am not going to reveal.
You are not going to reveal. I do have enough damage to take out.
Ooh, love it.
Yep. So I'm dealing 8. You have 7 defense. You will take 1. And my guys will go away. Okay. Let's get some cards out there. This. Okay. So Deacquisition Enforcer says at the end of your Dunes phase, you may abandon one card in your hand or treatment pile. So I am going to be doing that this turn because it will be at the end of my eventually. I went to the dunes, we came back and we said, so sorry, kid, you're not cut out for this. And we let him go. I'm going to reveal one for free. Ooh, there's another constable in there. Oh, I need to take a damage because Fire Pool of Blood continues to burn me. The placeholder text right now for this card says, see, I told you could light blood on fire. The quote is from our blood sage, actually, who, if you're following us on Instagram, you'll know blood sage last Christmas was very upset that we wouldn't let him use the New Year's blood that he saved up. Let's see. What do I want to do? I have no idea. I don't think I want to purchase, so I'm not going to. If I have, yeah.
Oh, no, come on. Spend that authority.
No. I'm gonna get rid of that sentry. I'm going to let Deacquisition Enforcer get rid of one of my guys. I'm going to end my turn. I'm going to do the responsible thing. and I'm going to.
Lame.
Yeah, lame. It's boring. It is boring. Okay, and it is Jeff's turn to attack me. Placeholder text right now. Oops. Okay. Let's do this. So we are going to give away another t-shirt. Change this graphic. I don't want to go to the other graphics I have just to... I accidentally lose my audio again. Everybody's telling me. So, if you're watching again, F in the chat. I have a whole bunch of these shirts, so don't be surprised that I'm giving them away. But if you are still watching, F in the chat, and we will go ahead and get you entered to win a t-shirt. Keep in mind, I will be messaging you personally to be like, hey, you won one of these shirts during the live broadcast. So, you know, if we're not friends on Facebook for some reason, then, you know, make sure to check your other messages. Otherwise, I'll probably just tag you on our Facebook if you win one of the giveaways. So, yeah. Awesome. Hey, thanks, Clayson. Okay. Oh, Jeff, you're pinging. What are we pinging?
We're going straight down the middle, my friend.
Straight up the middle. Oh, okay.
You know, this way.
Okay. And you're doing it with veteran militia. You may add +2 general synergy. You don't have any other general synergies. What? Okay, you're just
don't
running.
Worry
you're just
about
running
it.
The
no,
gun. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, no, everything's
okay,
fine.
Five. You're dealing five.
Big stuff.
Five, six, huh? And you're going up the middle. Okay, so because he's going up the middle, I can use either of these two cards. But he's dealing six. I have 10. Gonna do this, I think. Yeah, I think I'm gonna do that. Okay. Dealing six. Yeah, okay. I'm gonna do that. So I reveal the sentry. And you only have six?
You're right. Okay, I'm not getting any from anywhere else.
Okay, so he has six. So the reason for that is this guy takes two of that six, which means there's four left, and it doesn't matter which one of my two guys absorbs the rest. Neither of them will die because they both have five defense. So I will not lose either card. So essentially I sacked the sentry. I came up and threw him over the wall. To not take any damage. Gerardo over here with the sheesh.
Sheesh.
Yeah, I just yeeted one of my sentries over the wall for you millennials. No cap. Okay.
Ouch.
Yeah. Let's see. Pretty sure I'm an old millennial. Okay. Jeff is fortifying, so he's got a heavy gunner. So heavy gunner stays while attacking with heavy gunner. Target one defending attachment is advanced one stage before damage is dealt. So what this means is if he were to swing, let's say, at this wall, for instance, right? Before the damage is even calculated, I would have to advance this card one stage. So it can absolutely, you know, hurt me. Clayson said, yeah, so Jeff and I play differently. Jeff tends to sack his sentries more than his scouts early on. I generally try to get rid of scouts early on because I prefer the two kind of floating defense. But again, it's just different play styles, right? You get a certain amount of sentries and scouts. You can do pretty much whatever, you know, whatever order you want with those. Okay, and he's got to get down, Mr. President, again. I don't like the amount of ravagers I'm seeing. And he's got a medic, which tells me one of these two is probably a ravager. One of these two back here is probably a ravager because he's going to get down Mr. President, one of the other ones. You're about to hit me with that double damage again, aren't you?
Oh, Jeff. I wouldn't worry about it.
I wouldn't worry. Big things are coming. Big things.
Big things. Big stuff.
Okay, so I need to try and take out some of his cards. He's got a four. Jeez. Okay. So medic has stalwart and heavy gunner also has stalwart. Stalwart is bonus defense. So this heavy gunner is actually defending at seven. and this medic is defending at 6. So he has a 13 defense up the middle. If I go to the left or right, this way he still, this side, he still has stalwart because skilled is triggering it, and this guy can trigger it. So I think I'm gonna have to go this way if I want to take out or deal really any damage. I'm gonna go. Five. So we're doing 5, 6, 7 plus, and we're going this way. When does the president get to the choppa? Yeah, that's exactly, that is exactly the joke we are making. Get to the choppa now. For those of you who are part of my Frisbee family, I also got to make that exact same joke when we were filming for an announcement that's coming up. Kind of a, I'm kind of excited. I was up at MVP HQ last, that was 2 weeks ago, doing a bunch of filming for some commercials and that I'm excited about. And I made exactly that joke. Oh, okay. So his striker, so by revealing Blood Sage, his striker and melee allies get 2 bonus damage, but -2 defense. So, so the powder finger is actually a -1 right now. It doesn't kill him because I would have to assign damage in order to kill him, but it means his defense is significantly reduced.
For the purposes of your calculations, he'll be a 0.
Yeah, correct. He would be a 0.
When you're doing the math.
Yep, yeah, absolutely. Yep. Yep. Yeah. Negative isn't the number in this game. So Jeff has chosen to reveal. I am also going to reveal. And so I am swinging for 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. This takes 2 of it right away. So there is 7 coming back at him. And he will choose. So Powderfinger could potentially die here if he chooses any damage to carry over at all to Powderfinger. And the reason that that works that way is the defender assigns damage. So I tell him I'm bringing a big pool of damage. He chooses who to sacrifice.
So it's going to be
who's taking damage. So his normal Blood Sage right now is a 5-5, right? Because it's a striker and or melee allies. You are not your own ally, so he doesn't have to penalize himself for this. But so Blood Sage could soak 5 of it. Either of his other guys have -2 defense. However, Medic is getting stalwart, so that just cancels it out, essentially.
And neither one of those are actually, or rather, this guy does not get the negative. He's not.
Oh, right. He's not a striker or melee. So, yeah, right. Absolutely. Yeah. So he's not taking any negatives.
So Blood Sage is going away regardless. He'll soak up the
correct.
5.
So he'll soak up 5.
And then Medic will soak up the rest.
And then that is
the also issue. I'm sorry, did you rotate the up armor?
I did not rotate it for you. I just declared that the damage was being dealt to it, so you'll need to rotate it.
Okay. 2. Okay.
Yes. Okay. And I attacked. Oh, I take 1 damage because Fire Pool of Blood continues to burn me. Squad Leader's a good card. At the end of your Dunes phase, you may abandon a card. I think I'm going to buy Squad Leader just so I can Field Promote. So I'm going to spend 2. I'm going to buy Squad Leader. I'm going to Field Promote out my Sentry. And then I'm going to let Deacquisition Enforcer merc another guy. Then we're going to go from there. And that is the end of my turn.
Eric has another good question, Steve, while I'm working on my turn.
Sure. Eric asks, can you choose to take damage directly, or do you always have to assign it to defenders first? So unfortunately, you always have to assign it to defenders first. Cards on the wall are your barrier, essentially. So if he declares he's attacking this wall, for instance, then this card, this card, this card, and this card all have the potential to be in the combat. If I choose not to reveal one of my reserves, then they are not involved. But these 2 cards and any attachments are. They're an unavoidable situation. So all damage must be spread out amongst these cards before the HQ can take damage. Now, we have expansions coming that will add like a commander card. So the commander card will probably sit, you know, like in a space like right here or something like that, kind of out in front of your barracks. And they'll lend you bonuses, and maybe the commander card could be an associated, you know, attack lane. We're still working out the rules for that. But in terms of, can I just choose to take the damage to save one of my cards? No. And that's on purpose. That's part of the strategy of the situation. So Jeff is attempting to straight up end the game right now.
I see you say that, but you you had a very, very good
placement. I put Richter there on purpose. I knew what's coming.
Yeah.
I saw it.
Yeah.
So, Eric, now hopefully that answers your question. So Jeff is swinging for a bunch. Where are you doing it? And while you're thinking about that, I'm going to look at what's about to happen to me, because there's a bunch of things happening. So it's likely that this card...
You did it, though.
Yeah, it's likely that this card is a Ravager. So he's probably going to be dealing at least 6 damage from Salvager. Medic's going to deal 4, no bonuses. Gunner's going to deal 6. Bonuses. Powderfinger's going to deal Breach and Brutal, because I think he's got one skill, so he'll get to pick one of them. None of the other two have Breach or Brutal. And I don't know what that is yet. So he'll be evil. So Brutal damage is gain bonus 1 damage. Breach damage is just over the wall. There's no defense against Breach damage except for 1 card, maybe 2 right now. But Breach damage just means somebody fired a rocket at you over the wall. You don't get to defend it. You just take it directly to your HQ, which is you, the player. There is a card called Big Ass Bat. To make sure you put the hyphen in the right place, because otherwise it's Big Ass Bat. It is an attachment that stops Breach damage, because the bat like flies up and takes.
We're in this way.
Paul says leave him at 1 authority so his flaming pool of blood can kill him.
that's the pro move, Paul.
We debated on many occasions whether or not a card like that should exist for that exact reason. Like, could you just get killed by a flaming pool of blood? And the answer is absolutely.
You betcha you can.
If you light your walls on fire, you gotta suffer the consequences. So you're going which way?
He's gonna stand on top of the wall and he's gonna fall into it.
Correct.
We're going this way. Yeah, I'm not happy about it.
What is happening?
You played well. That's what's happening.
Okay. All right. It says when fire pulled, the blood ball is targeted by an attack, deal 3 damage to 1 deployed card. So I first have to choose whether or not I'm revealing. And I'm going to. I revealed. Jeff now reveals. And then once, squad leader. Oh no! Tell me you don't have another splinter or another. Oh, he does. Okay. Wow. You had a good turn. Okay. Yes. Exactly. He's pinging to let me know. So this is where we get to talk about faction synergies again. So the squad leader faction synergy, the mercenary faction synergy, is Protean. And Protean states that all cards now have all keywords. So all of his cards have close, versatile, defending, melee, striker, etc. So this is why he was also complaining, because if he attacked the wall with Richter Stonewall on it, he was unintentionally giving all of his cards a -2 while also giving all of his cards a +1 because he would end up giving all of his cards this thing. So there's a whole bunch of mechanics that are triggering right now. But essentially, because he has 2 mercenaries in the combat and squad leader has a 2 faction synergy, Protean kicks off. All of his cards get all traits. And essentially anything that says if your card has X, right? So squad leader and says while attacking with squad leader, other close allies have +1. It means all of his cards have close, which is one of the traits necessary to get that bonus. So it doesn't matter whether or not they had it or not. So all of these cards are essentially getting +1 damage. Do you have any other bonuses to straight damage other than Powderfinger about to just wreck my life?
No, no bonuses to damage, but we've got a heavy gunner that's going to advance the fiery pool.
Yep, so what happens here is, so one of his cards takes 3 damage. He doesn't have any bonus defense. He also doesn't have enough mercenaries to... So he doesn't have enough Ravagers to kick off Devastating, which is good, because none of them... Oh, wait, he does. Salvager. Yeah, except Fire Pool of Blood. I'm going to deal the 3 damage to Powderfinger, because I don't want to take both Powderfinger's damage and...
Smart.
Yeah, so what happens is that Fire Pool of Blood basically burns somebody. I think it also thematically makes sense. Powderfinger's covered in literally gunpowder, so he explodes while trying to leap the Fire Pool of Blood. He blows himself up, which means none of his abilities would trigger. He no longer has 2 Ravagers necessary for Salvager to get the faction synergy bonus. So Salvager won't deal double damage. It also means I don't have to deal with the fact that Powderfinger was already going to deal 1 damage to all of my cards anyways, which is nice because Powderfinger would literally kill the other Powderfinger. Okay, so you're swinging for... Oh, wait, this advances first before anything happens. You're swinging for 6.
You're going to take 2 breach real quick. 2 breach from squad leader.
Ah, yes, you are. Okay, so I take 2 damage. So squad leader has breach 2, throws a grenade over the wall, throws a rocket, however you want to do it. So I take 2 right away. I don't have anything that defends against breach damage. And then you're doing 6. Wait, all of them are plus 1. So 7, 10, 14, and then 5 is 19. So you're dealing 19, right?
Minus 1, just because you gave 1 to squad leader as well.
Oh, I did. You're right. Thank you.
Yeah.
So 18. Yep, 18. So you're dealing 18. I assume you're choosing not to also hit Fleshy or Fire Pool of Blood again.
I will choose to hit it.
Okay. So because it's silver on the edges instead of black like this one, he can choose whether or not he wants to basically try to like throw a bunch of dirt in my Fire Pool of Blood and make his life easier. He does. So that will take off 2 of that. So you have 15 damage coming my way.
I think it was 16 left.
Was it 16? Okay. Yeah. And then, yeah, I'm going to take 5, 6, 7 off of it. So I will take 9. That seem right?
Yep.
That hurt.
Well, you did 2 smart things. The first one was the turn before where you attacked the wall that you should have. Mm-hmm. I was kind of trying to bait you into taking the other one, but you attacked the wall that you should have. And if I had been able to keep the medic and the blood sage, I think that turn would have ended you.
I believe it would have, yeah, because you would have had 2 cards, right, getting faction synergies, because I think blood sage has
faction synergies. And there would have been some other stuff keeping you from hurting stiff.
Yep.
Yep. Good job.
Okay, so while Jeff is fortifying, right? Yeah, we get super excited about board games. Splintered Lands has been something that Jeff and I have been working on for 6 years. We are very committed to both the board game experience itself, right? Like, we want to make good games. But Civil Dawn Games, specifically the company that we're making, is designed to be a digital publishing company or a publishing company for other people's board games. We want to help indie creators make their games, right? We want to teach them all the ways to do it. We want to talk to them about, you know, like good game design, good player design, good mechanics, those kinds of things. And then we want to make games too. So Splintered Lands is one of those things where we are achieving basically both. This is the first game in like 3 or 4 that we have kind of pre-designed. Splintered Lands is our, you know, tactical deck building game, because we're big fans of deck building kind of games. It is an LCG, so living card game, which means when you buy boosters, they won't be in the cellophane packs and you get a random assortment of cards. You'll buy specifically a booster that has like these cards, so you'll know what's coming in the expansions, because we have 5 expansions already planned, and each expansion just adds more to the game for you to do. It adds more factions, and it adds kind of equipments or attachments or things. We have like an events one coming where, you know, stuff will pop up in the middle that essentially happens to both sides. And we're hoping, you know, that during our Kickstarter, we'll be able to fund those expansions as well. Okay, Jeff, you done?
Yes, I am.
Okay, perfect. Did you already end turn and shift?
Yes, I did.
Okay, so it is my turn. I am... What am I doing? I don't want to leave him like... Oh, he swung with everything, so he's missing. Bird. Constable, he's got Coalmaster, he's got Wastelander. Okay, let me think about this. I think... This card's two. Two. Five. Three. Six. Think I'm okay. I'm gonna do this. So I'm swinging for four plus, going this way.
Ah, I was muted. That's what's going on. Which way are you going?
Yeah. If you are currently still watching, I am posting a link to the Kickstarter in the chat right now. Our Kickstarter is planned to launch in April. In fact, while we're talking about that, I will update this graphic thing.
Which way did you say you were headed, Steve?
I'm going this way.
That away. Okay.
Yep. So if you're in the chat right now, Kickstarter is coming. April is technically April 15th is when we have planned. We're hoping, you know, no bumps or issues between now and then. So we would love if you can click that link, go and sign up to get notified. If you don't have a Kickstarter account right now, that is perfectly okay. You can go to our website, which while Jeff is deciding what to do, you can go here to civildawngames.com. And then you can come down here and sign up to get notified when it goes live. We are planning on going to Kickstarter, so you will at some point want to have a Kickstarter account. We will desperately love you forever if you go and support our Kickstarter in April. Okay, you're not revealing, Jeff?
Nope, I'm not revealing.
Okay, so I'm going to swing with Ravager Boss. I was going to try and save him. But I did not think that I had the ability to. So he doesn't have versatile, and none of them are getting any additional bonuses. And
you didn't get to pop that devastating.
I didn't get to pop devastating to turn him into an 18, which is incredibly unfortunate. but yeah, so I'm swinging for 9, 13, because I'm getting no additional bonuses. I'm swinging for 13 this way. Still,
I'm
a chunk.
I'm trying to man up, but it hurts real bad.
It does hurt real bad.
Let's see here. Yeah, we're going to take that one. Don't have a choice there.
Yep.
And then not revealing there. So that's how much you put in?
13.
13 minus the one is 12, minus five, and he's not getting any other bonuses. Yeah, so minus five is 8.
Yeah, not as big of a hit as it could have been, but not the tiniest of hits.
Gonna be over in pretty quick here. I don't know if I don't get you this turn, I think you're getting me next turn.
Me. I'm not gonna buy. I don't even know.
Come on, buy stuff. Just buy all the things.
No.
Buy all the things.
Oh, I take one damage. I'm going to go ahead and abandon that scout.
Fire Pool is going to do all my work for me.
Right? Fire Pool Blood's done like 5 damage, man. I'm just like, it's
true, but he's done maybe 5 to you, but honestly, he prevented more with that one turn.
That was huge. The fact that you didn't deal double damage to me or deal 1 damage to all of my cards was massive. So I'm not upset.
No doubt.
I'm very happy. Hey Jeff, Bethany's telling you to man up. I don't know who that is.
No, it's okay. I saw that. I answered her.
Correct. Yeah, you're in the desert. Things just kind of happen. Paul, sandstorms, robbing marauders, and so on. So Splinterlands doesn't specifically take place in the desert. Dunes is just a generalized term for the wastes. that we use. It makes more sense to people, because when we tried to kind of, you know, use Wastelands, people, like, it was a cognitive thing. But we will have, so the playmat will actually be, and we'll talk about this a little bit, the playmat will actually be three unique mats, with the ability for the center of the playmat to be different landscapes. So if you guys want to be in a snow area or an arid desert or a high plains or a cityscape, we have one of them that's planned that's basically like a destructed area. The world of Splintered Lands basically takes place 200 years after our current modern era, where an evil corporation essentially got mad, tried to take over the world, didn't work. So they released a bioweapon. We may or may not change that. Released a bioweapon onto the rest of the world, and it just devastated the world. Again, I'd like to point out, we designed this 6 years ago prior to our current political climate, so no pun intended. We weren't making political statements at the time. But yeah. So, let's see. Taylor, I do indeed witness you, sir, and we will ride shiny anew into the greater world. Yeah, you're going that way with 3++. I mean, I assume you're trying to take me out, so... let's see. Does that... Oh... What could you possibly...
decisions?
Yeah, and you didn't take the call master.
Ah, what does that mean, though?
Are you sloughing again?
What does it mean?
How is that possible? How do you have nine of your? No, you only have two of them. You can't be sloughing.
I don't know.
This is so frustrating because I don't know whether or not I should reveal. Because if I do, I don't know if I can beat you. You also didn't fall for my ploy, which is.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I know. What do I got here? Okay, so if I trigger here, I'm two, three, so I'm defending five right now. You're dealing three, four, five, six, seven at the best.
Paul, while he's thinking, I don't know if Steve already said this, but that that events deck is actually an expansion that is planned.
Correct, yeah. I'm not going to reveal. I feel like this is a terrible choice, but I'm not going to reveal.
Oh,
I know. Nah. I know.
Oh, no, it was the right choice.
Partially didn't fall for it.
It was the right choice. Nah, it was. Okay.
It was. Oh, that's so that's so frustrating, though, because it is going to hurt, but it was a good choice. It was a good choice.
You just have straight 10 coming at you.
Just straight 10? Okay. So one of it gets taken there, which means he's up armored walls is on its last phase, so I have 9 to deal with. He's going to defend 2 of it, and he's going to defend 3 of it because he is close.
Squad
leader is helping him out. Hang on a sec.
That's what I was counting.
No. Yeah, nothing else happens. Okay, so that's 5 being taken away, and then I will take 5.
Plus 1 for the wall.
Yeah, correct. Right. So 10 minus 1 is 9, minus 5 is 4. So I'll take 4.
There you go. And then advance your wall.
I already did.
Ah, okay, gotcha.
Yep.
Okay. Let's see here.
Hi, Jazer. Thanks for joining us. Okay, so while Jeff is finishing up the rest of his turn, so we are planning on doing these playtests. I'm gonna try and do one every week. But what I would love to do is get people who have never played to playtest with us. So if you are at all interested in playtesting, hit me up on Facebook or Discord. All of those links to all of those things you can find on our website. So if you go to civildawngames.com, you know, we've got all the social links. Or you can hit us up on here on Facebook. You can message us because, I mean, it just goes to my phone. So it'll be me that you're messaging. And I would love to play with other people. Like I would love to do a live stream with somebody it was their first time playing. I'm not going to let you in, but like, I would love to, you know, like, let you play the game and show people. Again, to reiterate, Splintered Lands is a physical game that exists. So here is a copy of the game. This is just an alpha copy, right? But, you know, there are cards. It is not a digital board game. The Tabletop Simulator is just so that we can talk about the game and show people the game. to a broader audience. There are a few people like in the chat who have played the physical copy game, because pretty much anytime I can sucker somebody into sitting down with me, I do it. Shout out to Cabbages and Kings board game shop here in Peoria, Illinois. Dan is fantastic and has been extremely helpful. We have done some live playthroughs at his place. So if you're in the central Illinois area, definitely go check out Cabbages and Kings board games, or check them out online. Dan's one of the coolest. I'm a big fan. So
absolutely.
Yeah. And thank you very much, Dan, for all the support. He lets us raid his place and put up signs and, do our playtesting in his shop. So, Jeff, you're done?
Yes, I am.
Okay, cool. So, start of my turn, Fire Pool of Blood, still continuing to just absolutely wreck my life. What do I want to do? I mean, yeah, that's what I want to do. Okay, so we are going to swing for 3++. And what does he have going on here? Squad leader, he's got a Call Master. Okay, so he's got Protean, which means all of his guys are getting +1 defense as well. However, go this way, none of it is active. Well, let me rephrase, it will be active, but...
That's right.
He's got the least amount of defense being shared on this side, because that'll be a 4, and that'll be a 7, that'll be a 5, and that'll be 8. 8 this way -1, but they're both -1. So I feel like I'm being beat. Problem is, I like taking the Claw Master out because I don't like want to get devastated. Okay. I'm gonna go this way.
Alright. So this funny enough, this was actually mostly accidental, but it's going to hurt, I think. So we're going to reveal that.
Oh, it wasn't a trap, but it was.
Oh, no, and actually, no, you're good. You're good, because he's not getting his stalwart to pop off. We'll see what happens.
You don't have any, you don't have a skilled? Oh, no, because, yeah, because squad leader is not involved. So, yeah.
Yep.
So the way that this works is I am attacking this wall, which means only this card, and this card are a part of the combat for purposes of triggering certain abilities. Even though squad leader is giving certain things away, the way that it works in our language in this game is very specific, right? For those of you who are Magic players, right, you'll learn that like the way you say things matter a lot. So things that say like you may do a thing means if you forget, it's your fault, it doesn't happen. But there are also things that say while a thing is happening, that means it's always on. You can't like turn it off. If the condition is met, it happens. So in this case, it says while squad leader is defending. So all of the cards on the wall are getting a bonus +1 if they are a defender or a versatile card or both, right? Regardless of whether or not I'm attacking his wall. However, he doesn't get to add his breach or skilled to this attack or defense because he's not involved. Squad leader is passively giving everybody a benefit, but breach and skilled can only be triggered if you are a part of the defense. So these cards are the ones a part of the defense. And so they will get to apply all of their abilities and their trait text, but squad leader cannot. He's only passively giving his guys +1 defense. However, he is giving it to... Are you triggering Protean right now?
Oh, yeah. Protean's on. Yeah.
So he's triggering Protean right now. So squad leader is giving all keywords to all cards. So they're all getting +1, basically.
That's right.
So he's a 3, he's a 5, and he is a 4. So that's 9, 10, 11. So... 12. So you're 12. So
+1 is 13. Eight. No, I think you're a little short. We've got 5. Oh no, sorry, I read that wrong. 5, 8, and yeah, no, we're at 12.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Paul, you don't have to fly up. The whole point of doing it digitally is that we can play it. Is that we can play it online. I can totally have you come on here and play. Like me, you'll have to censor your language just a tiny bit, so our game is kind of violent and gory. Like, I'm trying not to swear a whole bunch because I know your kids are probably watching. mine are like taking naps because it's nap time. So Jonathan may be watching. Hey, buddy. Probably upstairs on his tab. Also, my wife is definitely watching. Hello, Heather. Thank you very much for all your wonderful support. Okay.
And Mark, I think we absolutely could facilitate that. We really appreciate the interest.
Yeah.
Okay. So you've got how much coming at me here?
Yeah, so I'm swinging for three. So striker and melee have plus two damage. I don't have any striker or melee characters, so that doesn't matter. It's unfortunate. So I'm swinging for 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So I'm swinging for 10. What are you defending at?
Okay, excellent, excellent. So defending at 12. So, okay,
so this goes first.
Yep. That's going to go. That's going to take one. So, oh, actually, sorry, 13, including that. So 12 left. I did not factor in the up armored walls. So 12 defense left. And that means you've got how much left?
Nine.
Okay, nine. So we are going to preserve these two cards. No, just the one. Just the one.
Yeah, you get to pick. So, you get to keep one of them because you're going to lose heavy gunner, and then you're going to keep either call master or sentry.
Right. We're going to keep call master.
Shock.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then no damage carries through.
Okay.
Okay. So that was mine. This. This.
Oh, that fiery pool of blood nonsense.
Right? Okay. And I take one damage for fiery pool of blood. And oh, shock troop. Hey kids, look away. This is shock troop. She's a fantastic card. She is one of our uniques. But she has a really interesting mechanic. So it says when shock trooper is deployed or revealed from the reserves to attack. So if you flip her over to attack, your opponent may not reveal the targeted card this turn. If it was already revealed, turn it face down. It is no longer in play. So shock troop just takes one of your opponent's cards and says, no. It's basically all it is. She pops in over the wall. She kicks him down and says, this one, you don't get to play. Or this one, you just pick a card and flip it over. So it is a very good way to completely ruin somebody's defense. For instance, if Jeff had shock troop, he could come over here and just nerf Richter and cause me all kinds of problems. Okay, so that was my fortify. Gosh dang, I want to buy it, but I don't. Because
oh, please do.
No.
Oh, no, you can do it. No, it's gonna be fine.
I'm not going. Yeah, no, I think I'm good. I don't have the authority left to spend in me. Instead, I'm going to. Oh shoot, I already shuffled. Well, that's my bad. I was going to abandon a card from my hand or discard pile for not purchasing.
Missed opportunity.
But I did it wrong. Okay, and it is Jeffrey's turn. Okay. Let's look at chat. Hey, chat, how you doing? Okay, if you are just joining us, because I keep seeing our live viewer numbers go up. If you're just joining us, we're playtesting Splintered Lands. It's a tactical deck building base defense card battler game designed by my partner Jeff. Hang on a sec. Look at how fancy he looks, everyone. Look at this handsome gentleman. Look at him.
Take it in. I still don't know where you found that picture.
That image is like 10 years old, too. It's great.
Yes, it is.
But yeah, no. So it's designed by Jeff and myself. It's been 6 years in the making. It is the first game from Civil Dawn Games, which is the board gaming publishing company that we are developing. So yeah, we've been working on this game real hard, and we're real proud of it. We're hoping to be at Gen Con this year. I won't have the finished game will not be at Gen Con. We're kickstarting in April. So for those of you that are, you know, just joining us, we are kickstarting in April. I have a link to the Kickstarter right now in chat. We will be at Gen Con. We will be in the playtest hall. I just finished setting our events, actually. So if you, and registration for Gen Con badges just opened. So if you picked one up, definitely, you know, keep an eye out. But there are game, basically playtests where you can sit down and play a full game of Splintered Lands with either myself or Jeff or potentially another player. We will be really excited to have.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Jeff, where are you swinging?
So I am swinging the same direction as before because, you know, you're the worst. So we're going that way. Yeah. You betcha.
I'm absolutely going to reveal because if I don't, I'm in trouble.
Yeah.
Gen Con is August, I think like 4th through 7th or something. It's always the first week or tries to be close to the first week in August. Badges just went on sale. So if you want to go, you will need to go to the Gen Con website and get one. Because they, in previous years, they've sold out. I don't know what post-pandemic years look like. But in previous years, they've literally sold out of badges, like 80,000 badges or something insane like that. So yeah. Eric,
typical
yeah,
game. You have sorry, to go ahead.
Mark asked, how long is a typical game? For the first time you play the game, probably 90 minutes. Every game after that just gets progressively shorter because it's the mechanics of the game that take the most time, right? Reading the cards, knowing how they work. Kind of like Magic, you know, the first time you play a game, it takes a lot longer because you're like, what are all these rules? Because our game is designed to be complex without being excessive, meaning, again, once you understand what traits are, once you understand what synergies are, it's very fast. It's incredibly fast. You know, Jeff and I could play a game in a half an hour if we both play fast and risky.
I think we've done shorter than that.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, yeah. if one of us has an excellent play, then yes.
Yeah.
Like if and someone also, gets if, a couple of legendaries and persistent strain, game's over, you're gonna win.
And if one of us isn't Jeff, who takes forever on his turn.
That is also true, Jeff. I told Jeff specifically for this playtest, you must play significantly faster than you would like. Otherwise, his turns take like 10 minutes each.
Yeah. All right. So going that away, and
you can reveal I'm that other be a gentleman. Card?
Well, I'm going to be a gentleman and remind you about Fiery Pool of Blood. That would actually happen before I reveal.
Does it?
It sure does. When the wall is targeted. And I have declared it as a target.
Okay. Well, I can't deal damage to a face down card. Let's see. Call Master.
I think you could. I think it'd just be a little silly.
I'm going to deal it to squad leader. I don't like all the things going on. And Call Master would just let you get rid of some cards for free. So I'm not going to do
that. Hurts real good.
Mm-hmm. You're welcome. Okay. Now you reveal.
Yeah. And let's see here. Just so you know, that had one.
Mark, right now it is two player. There is an adventure mode being designed that would allow multiple players to play together, though it's in the very rough stages. If our Kickstarter is fantastic and I'm able to devote time towards developing it, then I absolutely will. Because I like cooperative, kind of collaborative games as like a really fun way for, you know, like Heather and I to be able to play and do stuff together. Right now it is a two player, you know, you versus the other person style game. If we're able to expand it into those things, I will. You're bringing a Blood Sage. Oh, no. Did you trigger its ability? Oh, yep. There it is. Okay. Well, thank you. So he is getting devastating because he has two Ravagers, which means Call Master is dealing double damage. Blood Sage, thankfully, is not, because that would be 10. But Call Master is. So Call Master is dealing 8. Medic is dealing additional 4, so that's 12. Blood Sage is dealing 5 more, so that's 17. And it's striker and or melee, and you don't have any striker or melees, so you're dealing 17.
Yep.
Okay, are you ignoring Fire Pool of Blood or not?
Let me count. let's see, 2, 4, 6, and
so I'm gonna take 11. I'm gonna take 11 damage, so I will have 2 left.
6. Then I.
I will have 1 after Fireball Blood. Either that beat hurts, next turn
it
or
hurts
I lose.
So good. If I had 1 more damage, we would have let Fiery Pool kill you.
Yeah,
oh, that's very it hurts. Okay, no. I'm not going to. Well, is it on its last phase?
No, its last phase is this one. So it's got 2 phases left.
Okay, no, I'm not going to do it.
Okay. All right. So those are down, and I will lose 11. I will have 2 hit points.
Hurts so good.
The funny part is Paul called it like at the beginning of me buying Fiery Pool of Blood. He was like, let Fiery Pool of Blood kill you. and I said, man, that'd be incredibly unfortunate. And I'm going to be honest, if I don't kill you this turn, you could literally just pass your turn and Fiery Pool of Blood will kill me at the beginning of my turn.
How long it?
Hilarious. Paul says, let the fire get him. Yeah, no, it's clear that's what's going to happen. It's incredibly unfortunate because I don't think I can deal. Oops. Ah! I'm alt-tabbing things. I don't think I can. What is happening?
West.
There we go. I don't think I can deal enough damage.
Thanks, Uncle Scott. All right, Steve, there's an operator up here. I think I'm going to ignore it.
Bethany says, I like that pipe picture as a Kickstarter reward.
Yeah, that's a hard pass.
we have stretch goals in already designed for a Kickstarter. One of them is things like some alternate foils. This is one of those times where I'm going to pimp, you know, the Kickstarter just slightly. So again, there's a link to our Kickstarter right now in chat. So we are going to have an option for somebody to put themselves into the game as well. There'll be a very limited number of those. But you can essentially help us design, you know, a character or a card or something like that, and we'll put you in the game. Another part of that is that there will be a promo pack. We've got a number of cards that'll have alternate arts, essentially. That'll be like a Kickstarter exclusive. However, to those of you who run a board game store, please note, I'm not planning on leaving you out of that. There will be a, you know, dealer option, essentially, to acquire all of the things with the Kickstarter exclusives. So that you can also offer those to your customers. We are building the game designed to be in stores, so it will not. We're not planning on bypassing the retailer market either. So, yeah. And Paul said, "Make it an NFT." No. as much as I am actually the exact kind of tech nerd that may or may not do that, I'm not planning on doing NFTs yet. We may or may not discuss it later, but right now I'm not going to come out the gate with NFTs as a part of the Kickstarter. Yeah. Okay. Jeff, are you done?
Yep. Yeah, it turns over.
Okay, cool. So Jeff is done. So now we decide or find out whether or not I'm about to get murked. Because to start my turn, Fire Pool of Blood deals me 1 damage. And I am going to swing with everything because I lose next turn if I don't. Jeff has left a very obvious ploy. Means this, whatever this card is probably his biggest defense. He would be silly not to, but he's sitting on 1... 4 defense here, and 2-3 defense here. Problem is Jeff also knows that I would know that, so did he put his better defense 1 here? I genuinely don't even know if I can deal enough damage to kill the problem.
I won't flip my reserves just like you want. I'm willing to fall into that trap for you, buddy.
Oh, I'm gonna tell you that it's a trap. I feel like I have to fall for it. I'm going to go this way. I feel like I'm falling for it. I fall for it. I fell for it. I fell for it.
I don't know about fell for it, but
what was my other choice? I can't change my mind now. I mean, it wasn't much better. I definitely picked the worst of the two, but it wasn't
worse. I was hedging. I had to.
Yeah. Okay. So, I'm going to reveal. Hey, guess what? I wasn't bluffing.
Oof.
So let's see.
It doesn't trigger,
which is very unfortunate
because that's okay.
You took out my salvager. I was hoping to save one.
That's
of them.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm not going to just immediately kill you. So hang on a sec. What bonuses to defense are you getting? You're getting
just stalwart 1.
Just stalwart 1. He's not closer first style. Okay. So you're defending at 6, 7, 8, 9.
That's right.
Okay. And I'm dealing 9, 12. Close and versatile allies are either the, okay, 13. 2 doesn't matter.
Yours will be straight damage as well.
Richter Stonewall is giving +1 damage to the Wastelander because she's versatile.
He's giving +1 defense to her.
Oh, you're right. Thank you.
Nice try.
I'm doing my best. I got 1 turn. 9. So yeah, straight damage. So 9, 12, plus 4 is 16. So I'm doing 16 this way, and you are defending at?
What did we say? 6, 7, 8, 9.
Yep. So you're going to take 5?
Other way around, 7.
7? Okay. It doesn't matter. I don't know why I'm doing a thing. Because it doesn't matter. Hey, look, there's Hellion Glorious Champion, one of the leaders and uniques and legendaries of the Splintered Lands world. And also, I don't know if you noticed, but an amazing piece of art. Thank you, Sam Eastwick, for gracing us with your incredible art. Because Hellion Glorious Champion is one of the cooler pieces that we've definitely mentioned. You're gonna end up that'll probably be on the box cover. Spoiler alert. I'm not gonna buy it, clearly. Or maybe I buy it and kill myself, and that's exactly what Hellion would like. And I take away your win. I can't buy it anyway, so I couldn't. I could bid one authority to go after it and flip a card and just, you know, kill myself in the background. But Paul called it earlier, so I'm not going to.
I will point something out that's fascinating to you. If I can manage it, I will let Fiery Pool of Blood kill you.
Well, you absolutely can. Just end your turn, and it'll kill me.
No. It's the beginning of your fortify phase. You're going to have an attack before your fortify phase comes.
Ooh. And I feel you. I will acquiesce if you would like, because Paul called it in the beginning. I'll allow Fiery Pool of Blood.
Like we all win.
Yeah, we all win here, man. It's the world of splinters.
Stand on top of your wall and just fall back into that pool. Let it welcome you.
Yeah. I love that when we were talking with Sam about drafting the card for Fire Pool of Blood, he was like, so what is that? And we had to, like, you know, talk through what in the world that would be. And then there was the discussion of, can you even light blood on fire? You know, and we had to, like, think through, like, is there a thematic way that that is possible? And so it was just, you know, all kinds of, like, really interesting things that we talk about, right? When we talk about the art for the game, you know, those are definitely things that, like, we dig into and think about, because we, you know, I mean, we care about some semblance of realism. There's some things, you know, that aren't. For those of you that saw the Instagram post that I posted where two of the characters were singing the song back and forth to each other, those are two new pieces of art that aren't in the game at the moment. But the one of them is known as Florida Man, and we're very excited for that piece of art. It's pretty hilarious. So... Jeff, you gonna pass and let Fire Pool of Blood kill me?
Oh, I'm passing all day long.
Okay, perfect.
Let's just end that turn real quick.
Perfect.
Cycle it through.
Perfect.
And then I want to see you click that button.
I will
right there.
No, well, not yet. It's not my fortify phase. I will be an absolute gentleman and let Fire Pool of Blood kill me. So,
yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, that is the end of the very first walkthrough for Splintered Lands. We will be here answering questions if you have any. Otherwise, thank you very much for watching. There is a link to the Kickstarter in the chat. We would love it if you could go and get registered to notify. If you don't already have the Kickstarter, go to our website. You can find us at civildawngames.com. Right on the homepage, you will be able to get notified for when the Kickstarter goes live. Kickstarter will be live April 15th of this year. We would really love for you to join us there. I am going to do another one of these live streams throughout the week. I'm going to try and do one every week between now and the Kickstarter. We'll see how that goes, because, you know, dad life. But we will try to do one. If you are interested in playing, I would love for you to let me know. Like, message us and say, Steve, this sounds like fun. I want to try it. Because I would love to play with other people. You know, this specific playthrough was, you know, we were going to sit down and play and talk about a lot of things. But the next ones will be us playing and, you know, interacting with you and having a good time. I will be doing more giveaways. So pay attention to your messages. If I reach out and ping you and say, hey, you won one of those shirts or a set of dice, you know, we'll be sending you one. But yeah, if you have any questions, let us know. Otherwise, you know, we appreciate you joining us for the very first broadcast of Splintered Lands. If you have feedback, if there's stuff that you saw that you liked or didn't like, if you think that there are ways that we can improve the game, you know, we are open and welcome to any and all feedback. Civil Dawn Games is born around the idea that we try to be intelligent with our words and we try to be intelligent with our actions. So if you're like, hey, I have an idea and I think it would improve your game, great, we'll listen to it. If you are an indie game designer and you are interested in having your game created, you should definitely reach out to us and let us know. That's a thing that Civil Dawn is born from. We are going to be helping other creators get their games designed and made. I personally have 20 years of experience doing game design and game theory. Jeff has many, many years of experience doing game design and writing. Jeff comes up with a lot of the theme and design for the game. We have collaboratively built almost all of the cards. We're here and ready to do stuff. We will not be helping you or signing contracts with people until our Kickstarter is done, because we want to prove to the rest of the world that we can do a thing. But we are open to hearing about your games. So, yeah, if there are questions, we will go ahead and answer them now. Otherwise, thank you very much for joining us. We are
absolutely.
Yeah, we are Civil Dawn Games. Splintered Lands will be launching in April. And that's where we'll cut the VOD. The rest of the live session will be if we're here for questions. Paul, you said you're here for questions. Did you have one? That was the unfortunate part. Like a, I don't know, like 10 or 30 second delay or something like that. And Michael says he appreciates all of you as well. Michael, our art director.
Michael, we appreciate you more than you know.
Correct, yes. We appreciate Michael incredibly. I'm going to commit the faux pas and drink on camera. That I just mean. Okay, sweet. No additional questions. Thank you very much, everybody. Have a good time. By backing our project, you're supporting indie developers with a passion for making games and supporting their fellow creators. Pledge today and help us bring Splintered Lands to your local game store.